Hi, my name's Ed Frawley. I own Learburg. I'm here today with one of our instructors for our online course, Mark Keating. And this is something we're going to try and do with every instructor that comes to our online university and either teaches a self-study course or teaches an interactive course. Because I think it's important that people understand the background of our friends that we choose to do courses with. So for the next couple of minutes, I'm going to talk to Mark, and he's going to tell you a little bit about what his experience is as a dog trainer and what his experience is as a teacher. Mark, at this point, teaches a couple of courses for us. He teaches an interactive course on relationship games, and he is working on several other courses with us. We don't need to talk about them right now. When we produce a new course, we're always going to do a little interview like this and talk about it. So, but before we get into any of that, Mark, why don't you explain, how did you get involved in dogs? I mean, how long have you been doing it?
Professionally, I guess you could say, where I'm training dogs for other people since 98, pretty much. Before that, I had dogs growing up with my brothers. My brothers I have five brothers, and actually four of us are involved in dog training. Some do biting sports, a couple do biting sports. I have another brother in Chicago who does pet dog stuff. So we were always involved with dogs, we always had dogs, but I really started training my own dog in probably 95, and then started working with other dogs in 98. And since then, I've just, you know, been working dogs the whole time.
So, five brothers, huh?
Yeah.
I came from a family of six kids. Let's talk about fights.
Yeah.
When we were kids.
Yeah, yeah.
Was that the prerequisite for being a good decoy, is to learn how to fight
learn
with
how
your
to
brothers?
Dodge a punch, basically? Yeah, I think so. Yeah, yeah. It definitely, you know.
So you got involved in the beginning with French Rain?
Yeah, I was doing obedience type stuff and jumping, not like agility stuff, but more jumping stuff for a few years. And then when I saw the bite work, I really wanted to get involved in that. And started to do that stuff, actually in like 98. So, and that was when I started doing more advanced obedience things. So got involved in that, and then eventually drifted towards French Ring, which is probably, for everybody who likes doing bite work as a decoy, I think French Ring is the greatest avenue for us in terms of being able to compete and be, you know, artistic kind of and expressive, and then training is real fun. Mm-hmm. So got involved in that, but you know, now I'm 37, and we were talking earlier about how your body can only take so much of physical things, so now I'm doing more, working with some people, training a few dogs, but trying to work more into behavior, obedience, look more into that. Just look deeper into that. Study that even deeper.
But you're a French Ring certified decoy.
Yep, I was
level
two. I was certified in 2004, and did 35 or 36 trials
as a decoy.
Yeah. Trained, coached, and trained. I can't tell you exactly how many, but over 10 dogs to compete in the sport. I did the decoy super selection in 2007, and I won that out of the American decoys.
Did you fly to Europe?
No, I don't fly. Remember, I take the train.
You like flying, Mark?
No, I hate flying. That's something you can
do. You ever fly?
I have flown, and I have to fly again soon to work with another a rescue dog. But so
really?
I'm in a month or so, and so I'm mentally dealing with that every day. But
you'll have to. Well, I would like a videotape of when you fly. Just hold your hands up, and I want to see if there's a rainforest underneath your hands.
Oh, it's a traumatic experience for me. You know, maybe if we could come up with some relationship games for flying anxiety.
But what I'm going to do is, for all the instructors that want, I'm going to pay for them to go to skydiving school.
Okay.
Right. That's how I put myself through college, so I figure you can do that.
we're two totally different people, apparently.
So now, back to the dogs. Yeah. You competed with dogs?
I did. I handled a Dutch Shepherd that I got a ring one on, and then I got a Malinois from Mike Ellis, our friend, and competed that dog until ring three, and then retired him, and now he just hangs out. And to be honest, I'm not really a competitive person. That's just the reality. Some people really get, you know, they get off on competition.
I agree.
You know,
no,
they really
nothing wrong with that.
No, it's just it's to each their own. For me, it was something that I viewed to have a ring three on a dog, a French ring three. I viewed it as an almost unobtainable goal. And once I got it, honestly, as far as competition goes, all the wind was kind of out of those sails. Yeah. So I just coach people who have the same goals. And I enjoy it. It's fun. It's just as rewarding, and I don't have to deal with the stress of competition and all the things. Because when you're competing, it's the if you really know what you're doing and you know what you need to do at the end, it's incredibly time-consuming. And the amount of detail that has to go into every little thing is unbelievable. So it's fun, and it's great, and I'm extremely grateful of all of the details that I learned by going through that process. But like I said, I just don't have any interest right now in competing. What I'm more interested in at this point is changing behavior with a dog. Like, I think that's a much more profound thing, to change the dog's idea about a certain thing, whether they're afraid or of something, or nervous or anxious or dominant or any of those things. You know, by the course that we've been doing has also, just by teaching the course, has opened my eyes to other ways, less conflicting, that are fairer, you know, more fair to the dog and stuff. So that's kind of where I'm at, you know, at least right now.
So you, for your business, you run a boarding business, and you run a grooming business.
There's grooming there.
And then people bring in dogs for training.
Yep, boarding
training.
And then
you go and do private training lessons with people?
Yep, we do in-home lessons. We do private lessons at our place. We do, we have a group class that meets of advanced students, and then we also hold a group class for some other students. The big thing that we do, I think, as far as training goes, is we take a lot of dogs, several dogs, usually about anywhere between 7 and 10 dogs a month, different dogs that have all kinds of problems. So just to give you an idea, right now I have a Cane Corso who bit two of its family members.
Male or female?
Male.
How old is he?
He's just over a year, big dog. And when they dropped him off, was lunging at all of us, going for us. So now we're doing a lot. I mean, I hate to say it, but we've dialed in all that stuff, figured out what makes the dog tick and what makes him think a certain way, why he's thinking that way. And we've now got rid of all that, and now we're doing all this fun stuff. I mean, a lot of the things that we do in relationship games, because it's a lot of the same things that we do in our training with the dogs that stay with us. I also had a basically a feral beagle that, I'm not kidding you, that the first time I put the leash on the dog went completely crazy because she walked her in a harness. So the first time I touched the dog to pet her, she jumped 5 or 6 feet. And you know, I very rarely say this, but I do believe that the dog was physically struck, kicked, or punched, or slapped, or something, because of the way that she was reacting. So I actually, not to keep going back and plugging the course, but I had to do accept restraint with this dog, which is one of our games in the relationship games thing. Accept restraint is something that was very easy for me to understand. It was something Cindy taught me 6 months ago, 7, 8 months ago. But I had never really use those techniques. I just felt like I didn't have time. Like, oh, I'm in too much of a hurry. But now I know that, and then I've been watching students and seeing, watching students work with their same issues with their dog, and then me applying these techniques, it's really cool. That beagle went home today this morning. I can touch her, I can pet her, I can pick up her feet, I can pull on her ears, I can pull on her tail. She can take, you know, leash pressure. Beautiful, you know?
What I found interesting was what we were talking about a little while ago is that the relationship game course, and there's other courses involved here, but the relationship game course is an interactive course where people can use a smartphone, and from any smartphone they can take videos of their training, and with two clicks they can upload it directly to the forum so that you can watch what the people are doing for their training. And what I found interesting that I hadn't thought of that you told me is it gives you an opportunity when you look at the submissions from the people that are taking the course, you get to focus right in on that person without being distracted by 15 or 20 other people and dogs barking and pulling and everything else. And you can focus on it, and it gives you, and this is what I thought was interesting, how it's changed you, is what you, and maybe you should explain it, how it's changed you and how you approach your customers that are coming to you from what you've seen from these videos, mm-hmm. you know?
Well, it's, you know, I mean, a lot of people that come to me to see me directly have a problem, usually a big problem. I'd say 10% of the people come and they want to learn what we do because they want to, you know, train their puppy or whatever. Most people have a problem, so they're usually all ears. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I can kind of say whatever I want in whatever way I want, and I try to communicate it to them in as clear a way as possible. But what we have in this online course is people who don't have problems but want to do something with their dog. Mm-hmm. So because of that, I have to take a completely different approach, I think. Nobody's got a problem, and basically because of that, nobody's in a pinch. Nobody's feeling pressured or like they need to do anything. So it's really cool. I have to adapt from student to student and knowing, okay, well, here's a person, say, and the people that we have in the course are all over the map, from very advanced people to people who have virtually no idea about anything. And the way I talk to someone that's looking at them and looking at their dog and the way that they're interacting with the dog, seeing how the dog is responding to what they're doing, I can say, okay, these guys have something going on already. So I can talk to them in a way that's more advanced than someone else. Well, the cool thing is all of that information is accessible to everyone, and I'm constantly, and I believe everybody at Learburg, we're trying to do the same thing. We're trying to get these students to interact with each other so that a student who has a six-month-old dog and is just looking for something fun to do, again, the cool thing, in the comfort of their own home, at their own pace, you know, following their own schedule, they can do that, again, not be distracted by other dogs, but then they can comfortably, in a distraction-free environment, go back and watch these other dogs, see what they're doing, hear what I'm saying for them to do, and very seldom, you know, I sometimes will have to even get nitpicky because some people are so, their product looks so good. Mm-hmm. So I'll say, okay, well, I guess the next step would be advance, even though maybe we haven't talked about advancing, but I always give someone something to work on next, and I believe that all the other students are able to see that and kind of grab from it.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Cool.
Yeah, it's great. It's helped me huge with my own training, like I said, because I'm working with, you know, up to 10 strange dogs every month, turning over constantly, applying a lot of these techniques, and at the same time, learning from students, which is something I never anticipated happening. So, and I, you know, we can talk more about that.
Yeah, and that wasn't the purpose of the video, but it's still interesting.
Yeah.
Like in your business, mm-hmm. you run a small boarding facility. Mm-hmm. How big is that?
We have 55 runs, basically. Yeah, 55 runs. So
I didn't know that was that.
But we have a very good system, mm-hmm. And it's developed over the course of 18 years now. So we have, it's a small family-owned business kind of thing. We have few employees, good employees, but not too many. And, I've luckily been able to experience what it's like to run a boarding kennel, which is essentially you're handling strange dogs constantly.
Yep.
And, you know, some dogs are different. Mm-hmm. Some dogs are fearful when they come to a strange place and get dropped off. Some dogs are crazy, anxious, frustrated, just out of control, wild. And,
yeah.
You know, so it's a very valuable experience to be there.
So that's why, I mean, as an aside, mm-hmm. one of the courses that Mark's working on is a course on how to start a small boarding mm-hmm, facility mm-hmm. and how to run the facility, how to set it up, mm-hmm. what to expect, how to handle customers, mm-hmm. how to charge for it, mm-hmm. how to determine how much you should charge.
Mm-hmm.
When Mark came today, we talked about the theme for what we're trying to do here at mm-hmm. Learburg mm-hmm. on our online university, which is basically, I came up with it because it is what I want to do, which is follow your dreams mm-hmm. for people that either want to learn how to train at a very competitive level mm-hmm. or who want to learn how to just have a pet they can really live with, mm-hmm. love, mm-hmm. get along with their family. That's their dream. Or people who want to make a living mm-hmm. with their dogs.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's where I came from mm-hmm. back in the 70s when mm-hmm. I got out of college. There was never an issue of me ever thinking that I could make a living excuse me, from dogs.
Mm-hmm.
And here we are today, it's the same thing for you. Mm-hmm. I'm sure back in the 80s, you never thought you were going to make a living as a professional dog trainer.
Back in the early 2000s.
There you go.
I'm not kidding either. Yeah. I mean, it's a tricky thing to do. And, you know, honestly, especially, that's why this is so, it's really priceless, because up until now, with the exception of very few schools, I can only think of two, one of them's Mike's, where you can actually get good quality information mm-hmm. on dog training. And right now, there's so much smoke and mirrors out there in terms of dog training and you know, dog trainers and people who will take some kind of a course online with no actual dog interaction or very little, that's not being taught or assessed, basically evaluated. And these people go out and they end up, you know, being able to do it. So, and a lot of times those people don't have a good product. Do you know what I mean?
Or they're not getting the right information.
And they don't have a good product, ultimately, because mm-hmm. they've gotten the wrong, or they haven't gotten enough information. So it's really, you know, like you said, follow your dream. I mean, it's true. If somebody would have told me I would be doing this, especially like what we're doing now with this thing, you know, this is a dream for me, because like the people that are taking the course, I can train with these people in the comfort of my own home. Mm-hmm. So I don't have to stand outside in the field when it's raining or windy or cold get bit by a dog or you know, and it also allows me to watch the video, watch it again, and go, okay, this is the best way to communicate this, instead of just seeing something and going, oh, this is what's going on. Because sometimes as dog trainers, we try to be like dogs, we're here in the moment, mm-hmm. and I think we have a tendency, at least I do, to jump the gun a little bit with my assumptions.
Well, and I should say, for those people that don't know anything about our online university, I need to make the point that we have two different kinds of classes. Mm-hmm. You know, we have the interactive class where students are allowed to have live chats every week, or as a group, mm-hmm. where it's like they're sitting around a table mm-hmm. and they're talking to us through a computer. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I've sat in on a number of them with you, and it's just weird because there'll be somebody from South America mm-hmm. and China and, mm-hmm. you know, England
Malaysia,
and
Russia.
Russia, yeah, mm-hmm. Russia. It's amazing. Mm-hmm. It's just amazing. And the ability to do and submit videos. Mm-hmm. That's one part of this. But the other part, the self-study, there's no interaction. So mm-hmm. that end of it kind of goes to the people that think, online university, I don't want to go back to school. I personally have nightmares about what a terrible student I was in college.
Sure.
And I never studied, and the only thing I learned how to, I can't say the only thing I learned how to do, but one of the only things I learned how to do was drink really well.
Yeah, sure.
I have a degree in business. What they taught me was nothing.
Yeah.
And I have nightmares about, you know, oh, I got a test tomorrow and I went out drinking last night.
Sure,
That was stupid. Yeah. I'm very proud of the fact that I graduated with a 2.3 because it easily could have been a...
Was that your blood alcohol level?
1.5 GPA, you know? That's what I deserved. But anyway, for those people that don't want to have and feel like, hey, I don't know if I want to do an interactive course because I don't want to do homework or mm-hmm. I don't want to get into it that much, then they can go into the self-study. Like my basic dog obedience course is a 6-week self-study course. Nobody's sitting there to go take a video of your mm-hmm, dog. Mm-hmm. You don't have to sit on the live chats. You just don't have to do it. You do it at your own pace.
Yep.
And we just have like the engagement course.
Yeah.
You know, that's what we do.
I think the self-study courses are, I think the difference, I guess, between the two, and I haven't, you know, we're in the process of producing the self-study course. We call it Advanced Play Techniques, yep. which is basically designed to beef up the relationship with your play with your dog, and that transfers into all of your other behaviors. But when you're doing an interactive course, it is loose in the way like I can study, I can train at night, I can train in the morning, I can adapt to my own schedule, but you do have to have a video submission in by the end of the week. Yeah. And we do, it's a 9-week course, and we have a final week, which we've allowed for makeup work. I guess if you want to call it pressure, there's this, you know, tiny little smidgen of pressure in the way that you do have to have your video in each week.
Yeah.
That's the thing, that's your homework.
Well, and that's the kind of person, I mean, the people that are coming to you in your course, mm-hmm. are prepared to do that. They want it. Yep. That's important to them.
Yep.
And then there's other people that don't want to do that.
Absolutely.
And that's where we have the other option for them. So
I know. I think that I would make the assumption that anybody who comes to the university to learn, first and foremost, is probably, I think, like me, curious about dog training, wants to become a better dog trainer, first and foremost. Now, there's also other people that they love training dogs so much and they love interacting with dogs so much that they say, all right, how can I turn this into to something that I can do and support myself,
yeah,
basically.
And that's hopefully where we're going to lead them.
Well, that's the idea, right? You know? Give them the information so that they can go out and do that. They can supply the product. Like, mm-hmm. We're not going to tell people how to build a website. We're right. not going to tell them how to market themselves, how to do grassroots things, whatever it may be. What we're going to do is give them the information. We're going to teach them how to build the car, teach them how to build the house. You know, it's their job to do with what they want with it after
that.
So
we're doing like the boarding school, and then we're going to do, but for us, like, we're doing one with Gary Casera, who works with Michael mm-hmm. Ellis. Mm-hmm. He has a very successful business on dog walking.
Yeah.
You know, and you super, don't do that. Super. You don't do any dog walking.
No, but it's a totally valid industry, especially when you get into the city. I mean, it's like...
Gary works in Michael Ellis' school in California.
Yeah.
And he has his business that he started in New York City, and he has 5 employees working in New York City.
Well,
managing it from California, and he's doing a heck of a job. Yeah. We're going out there. We've already done a lot of filming with him. We're going out there and filming the actual street work and stuff with him. It's a good deal. But again, it's part of follow your dreams.
Yeah.
You want to make money in dogs, you have to learn how, and you might as well learn how from people that have been successful.
Yeah.
Rather than the school of hard knocks.
Yeah.
Because how many times can somebody get knocked down, make bad decisions, get sued, get dog bit?
Well, that's one thing that's very true that I tell people a lot, because I play music too. I've talked about that before with you. And, you know, you can learn something on your own, and you can continue to do the wrong thing for 7, 8, 9, 10 years before you get with a guy and he goes, you know, if you would just, you know, change this, you'll find your results are going to be dramatically different. And you would never know that until someone who's, you know, went through either somebody told them that, or they had to learn that after 25 years of doing it wrong.
Yeah.
But that's the beauty, and I tell everybody, anybody who wants to learn anything, study yourself, like self-study courses, it's great. And at some point, test your stuff. Go out and get evaluated, you know, critiqued by someone who you would feel like is a peer or someone who has more information on whatever you're doing than you do. So
some of the people that haven't seen the other video, mm-hmm. you know, may not know you're a musician too.
Yeah.
Tell me about that. What do you do?
I play, right now I'm really concentrating on studying guitar, mostly traditional type music, like old Renaissance music basically.
Yeah.
But I've been playing drums I've been playing music since I was 4, and I've been playing drums professionally from 12 until even now I still play drums professionally. So that was what I did, and I because of the lifestyle, which is, you know, some musicians love that stuff, man. They love the craziness of the crowd and staying up until 5 in the morning and sleeping till 2.
You go out and perform. I know you do.
Yeah.
Cindy and I have come and watched you.
Yeah.
It's great.
But now I'm performing in a much more relaxed, calm kind of, the risk of sounding pretentious, I'm playing to more sophisticated people where they're not throwing bottles at me and telling me to play Pretty Woman and stuff like that. So, I mean, and you think I'm being funny, but it's the truth. And the reason that what was happening was I started young, and then I got a dog when I was 18. I got my own dog that I was going to raise and train and stuff. And to be with a dog and, like, interact with a dog, or, like, you know, you've done it, Jeff does it all the time, you just go out and hang with your dog. Go get in the canoe and go for a paddle with your dog. It was so tranquil. And it was so, like,
from having bottles,
from being in this crazy environment. I mean, you know, I'd come home from that at 2 in the morning, and I'd grab a dog, and I'd go outside, and I would train, and it was just like, oh, this is great. So that was why I drifted towards training more. And then once I felt like, you know, I didn't ever think I could make a living doing it.
Yeah.
I thought that I could do it as a hobby, and I would have to play music to support my dog training thing. But I realized that when I wanted to learn, there, like I said, we've talked about this before, there was nothing like this at all. There were your videos. Yeah. You know, and I got to see some of those. There's nothing like this. And I literally was playing in a band on the road, lived in a cabin on the lake, like Jeff, like really, really great place. You know, everything was nice. And I quit it all to literally go broke just to learn about dog training, which I'm super grateful I did. But 6-7 years ago, I was wondering if did I make the right decision there? You know, life decision. But luckily, everything's shaped out, shaped up, and you know, opportunities and things like that. So it's I'm really fortunate.
Well, I think this is just going to go on and on. I mean, I don't know if vision is the right word, but I knew that online training had so much more to offer because we can keep the material updated. If you get another idea today that needs to go into one of your courses, we come out and we film it for 5 or 10 minutes and we throw it in the course.
Plug it in.
And that's been my problem with DVDs forever. You know, I mean, I made my first video in 82 and bought my first camera in 78. And I would do a videotape, and a year later, we knew a lot more than we did when we did it.
Yeah.
Well, to go back and redo a video, especially back in the VHS days, I mean, there's no copying over stuff. You can't just go and insert something in the middle of a VHS tape, you know, and then went through the high eight and then into the videos and even the DVDs. To redo a DVD is a tremendous amount of work. Yeah. But this is nothing.
Yeah.
And you're going to be able to keep it up to date.
Yeah.
On an ongoing basis, because you're taking some of the student videos and putting it into your course curriculum, right?
Yeah.
That's what's cool about it.
We call it peer instruction. So that's the, you know, like I mentioned before, it's just I think every week I learn something from a student who has, you know, a tenth of the experience that I do, maybe, or has worked with. They've worked with 3 dogs in their life, and I've worked with, you know, however many. So you'd think, well, how could, you know, but you can learn something from everybody. But I mean, just to give you a quick example, a woman was working with a deaf dog, okay?
In your course?
In our course.
Right.
She said, I'm working with a deaf dog, and I'm wondering how can we teach the dog marker training with a deaf dog? And so I started to think, and this was during a live chat call. So I started to think, and I thought, okay, well, obviously there's the visual cue. You can make a visual cue and couple it with a reward, and through consistency, the dog will learn. But then that's not very practical, because that would mean the dog would have to be looking at us all the time in order to receive the mark. So then I immediately thought of a Russian ballerina who is deaf, who would feel the vibrations through the floor. She'd feel the music, and that's how she would dance. So I thought, you know, you could tap your foot on the floor wearing a certain type shoe, producing a consistent sound, training in a consistent area, and the dog would feel that vibration and then make the association, which would, he wouldn't have to look at you, blah, 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 so on and so on.
Never stand in grass.
Yeah, exactly. Or don't change your flooring. But so I'm feeling pretty smart. And then one of the students says, what about using the vibration function on the electric collar? And I thought, well, that's perfect.
Yeah.
Now, of course, there's going to be a little bit of calculation or in terms of like the response of the vibration when you hit the button. You'd have to hone that technique a little bit to make sure that your timing is right.
But it's the same as a voice.
It's consistent.
Right.
It can reach over hundreds of yards. Mm-hmm. I never ever thought of that. Honestly.
Easier to do that than it is to holler at a dog that's 100 yards away and give him a yes mark.
If you think about it, like if you can, you know. Yeah. So it was just a very interesting something that I picked up from a student.
Sure.
So, yeah. It's a byproduct, it's a consequence that I never thought would ever happen, and it's made it even more rewarding on my end.
So what does Irina think of you doing online courses?
She loves it.
Does she?
She watches the videos with me.
Yeah?
Because, you know, she taught me.
Did she sit in on the Russian live chat and translate for you?
Well, no, she didn't sit in on the Russian live chat, but we have a student now who's from Russia, and I could not understand, and I understand some, and I could not understand what this guy was saying, and then finally she came in and she was able to, okay. But it was great because in this particular case, because what the guy was saying for a mark was something to the equivalent of like, yeah, I like it. Literally. Like, sit, yeah, I like it. Yeah, I like it. And so I thought, well, instead you could say da is yes. You could say da, you know, instead it's a single sound, something like that, or you could even say okay or something. Mm-hmm. So. So yeah, she watches the courses with me, and I mean it's fun.
Have you told her that when you do the course on the business that I want her in the videos?
Yeah, she's gonna have to be. Well, that's something that she's gonna. She's
good at it.
Yeah,
she's
I feel like I can help people with this course, especially people who want to start their own boarding kennel in their own house with a structure that they have, because I've my brother and I did that quite a few years ago, so I have experience there. But when it comes to the running of the business and stuff, everything I've learned, I've just learned from paying attention to the decisions that she's made. So we're now the kennel, you know, 96 it started, now we're 2014, so almost 20 years. We don't pump a ton of money into online marketing, stuff like that, and we just have a kind of a grassroots approach, and it's doing great.
Well, that's important. We need to mention your kennel name is Red Star Kennel.
Yeah, yeah.
And at Red Star Kennels, you do some breeding.
You
do everything as Red Star Kennel.
Yep.
And we'll put the web address on this video, so for you folks that want to go and take a look at their website, what they do, what services they offer, you probably should. If you're thinking about taking one of Mark's online courses, but you also do breeding. You breed what, Malinois?
We breed very, very little, and I'm not sure when we're going to have another breeding again, honestly.
One a year, 2 a year?
It's not even that.
Okay.
It's going to be pretty sparse, I think.
Because I don't blame you.
Just because we're getting older, we're slowing down in ring, and it's a very difficult breed to keep around, as you know. As you guys, you have them here, and you see, I mean, it's hard to keep them healthy. It's hard to keep them from hurting themselves. So, but we have miniature poodles too, and we breed very few of those, and we also have Presa Canarios. We just had a litter of those, and a litter of Presas, and we'll probably maybe do one more breeding of those this year.
Yeah.
And those are fun, easy to keep, and fun dogs.
They're cool looking dogs.
Yeah, cool, tough.
I bet the puppies
are
cool looking.
Yeah, we have a dynamite little puppy right now.
But your poodles are cool too.
Yeah.
I never knew poodles had the kind of drive that your dogs have. I never in my life knew that little poodles could be so cool.
Their drive is inexhaustible.
It is.
It really is. Yeah.
I didn't know poodles were like that until I saw Mark's poodles.
Me neither.
Yeah, really?
How'd you
get into poodles then?
I had them growing up, but I didn't know what I had. We just had a great dog. We had a really nice dog. And then I got a dog for my grandma for her 90th birthday.
Yeah.
And in that winter, I got him for her, and I raised him for a couple of months, gave him to her at 4 months. My grandma's got great dog intuition, incredible dog intuition. She taught him tons of stuff. She potty trained him. She taught him to fetch,
cool.
You know, all this stuff. And then when I got him back, because she got sick, I realized, I'm like, man, this little guy just goes and goes and goes. And then I ended up, actually, a couple of years later, starting to train him instead of just being a nice little pet. And the more I trained him, the more intense he got about training.
Yeah.
And then I thought, then I found another one, and we got a breeding female and started to produce them. And then the ones that we were producing were from quality stock, which are even better and even more. So it's a lot of little dog. People don't realize that, but it's a lot of dog in a little package that loves to do, loves to interact.
Well, we got a lot of video of them in the relationship game course.
Yeah, we do. A lot of mine, and then also Alex has one of our puppies here.
Alex works for us here, and he wanted a dog, never had a dog, and now he has
one of your dogs. And he's a cool
little poodle.
He's a nutty little poodle, too. He's a super driven little guy, loves to work. So. Yeah.
Well, good. I think what we're going to do is we'll wrap this up, but I also think that every course we do from now on, we'll redo a little interview more about what's in the course, how it's structured, and what the goals are of the course, and what people should expect to learn from the course. So we'll do one of those on each course that we have.
Okay.
Cool.
Great.
Thanks for coming by.
Thank you. It's always a pleasure.